take your Bibles and turn with me to Matthew chapter 5, and we are on verse number 7, chapter 5, verse 7, the third Sunday on this subject of blessed are the merciful, and that's our text. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. It's a joy to be here this morning, a real privilege to stand here and to declare, I hope to declare the Word of God, if my heart deceive me not. We are certainly subject to self-deception, aren't we? But we try to stick with the Word and every word that's in the Word and try to proclaim it as it is being taught and not to make merchandise of the Word and to destroy the Word or the power of the Scripture. We let the Scripture speak for itself. Matthew chapter 5, verse 7, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Please go to prayer with me. Father, we thank you because you're gracious and kind to us. You are full of mercy and grace, and that you have blessed us with many, many blessings upon this earth. And Father, as we're reminded each and every day of thy mercies, that they are new to us and refreshed to us every day, that they come from thy hand and thy hand alone. And Father, that because we have been the recipients of great mercy, that we too should be merciful. Father, we thank you in this. I pray that you'll help me to proclaim the word, that I should use the right words in the right order and the right means to convey the right message, and that you should take that and apply it to our hearts. They should mold us and make us into the people that we ought to be. And so, Father, I ask for your blessings this morning upon us, that Christ might walk in our midst and teach us thy word in his Son's name. Amen. We have been looking at mercy. Like I said, this is our third Sunday, and I believe it will be our last if I move along at an appropriate rate. I try to leave myself plenty of time to preach, and I hope to be able to fill that time up appropriately this morning. But we've looked at mercy. Blessed are the merciful. And we defined mercy. And we saw that mercy and grace are so closely related to each other that they really can't be separated from each other. We saw that grace was how God deals with our sin, with us in our sin. But then we see that mercy deals with man in the consequences of his sin. Because he is in sin, because he's a simple creature, God pours out his mercy upon us. And we've defined mercy. Then we looked at the duty of mercy. And we saw what the duty of mercy was in regards to one another, our brothers and sisters in Christ, that we were to put on, as the elect of God, holy and beloved, bowels of mercy, kindness, humbleness of mind, meekness, long-suffering, forbearing one another, and forgiving one another, and being kind to one another. That's what we're to do because Christ has done that to us. You see, we're to be merciful because we have received mercy. And then we looked and saw our duty of mercy to our neighbor. And we discovered that our neighbor, as Christ answered that scribe, he said, basically, that our neighbor is anyone that is close to us, who is close at hand. We saw how that the man who was from Samaria showed mercy on the Jewish man who was beaten and robbed and injured and left half dead, laying alongside the road. And we saw that his own countrymen who came by him ignored him there. And the man, most likely in the condition that he was in, would have died if he had not received some form of intervention. And we saw that this man who was, as far as a Jew was concerned, was his enemy, because the Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans. The Samaritans be a mixed race and a mixed religion. And we'd have to go in and study in Kings and the dispersion of Israel, and how that they were taken captive, and that by by this captivity, then there were people brought into the land who were not Jewish, and there was a remnant of Jews left there. And as a result, we have this mixed race and mixed religion of Samaritans. And they were as bad as the Gentiles. And the Jews considered Gentiles enemies. So we have this mixed race of people and a mixed religion between the heathenist religions and that of the Jewish religion. And they were hated by the Jews. They were enemies as such. But the neighbor, who is that neighbor? Anyone that is close by that you can help. That's who he is. Now this morning, I'd like for us to move on and see that the duty of mercy extends to enemies. Now I'm going to expound more, not just an enemy just because he was a Gentile or a Samaritan versus my particular people, which are Jews. So it's going beyond that. Now we're talking about those who are in physical or spiritual conflict with us. A declared or decreed enemy, if you will. The Japanese and the German armies in World War II and their allies became enemies, and we were in combat and conflict with them, were we not? So when we talk about my enemies, we are talking about those who are in opposition to us, not just people who we don't like. We might consider unbelievers as people we don't like, let me rephrase that. We might consider an unbeliever, a wicked man, to be like the Jew and the Samaritan. We aren't with them in their activities. We're not a part of them. They're, in a sense, they are enemies because they're enemies of God. But now here we have one who is a declared enemy, who is encroaching upon us, who is in conflict with us, who is in battle with us, who has animosity towards us, who hates us, and has no good plan for us. And this might be the hardest of all, to have mercy and to exercise pity to them who are our enemies, who are sworn enemies against us. Now, it might be your next door neighbor who throws his leaves in your yard and cleans up his dog poo and throws it across the fence in your yard because you are a believer, a Christian, and he hates you. And he's going to do everything he can. He's going to speak bad against you. He's going to do all sorts of things because you, in his mind, are his enemy. That's going to be hard for you to treat him in a nice way, especially when he's so belligerent and nasty towards you and curses at you across the fence, threatens you with harm. And it is so contrary to the human nature and to our flesh to be kind to this man. Not just tolerate him, but be exercise kindness and mercy towards him. It is so contrary to us to be able to do that, yet it is oh so much the nature of God. You get that? We might find it so hard to exercise kindness, let alone mercy, to that enemy across the fence or across the yard or next door or wherever he may be at work. And we may have a hard time exercising any kind of kindness or even a good thought towards him. Yet it is all so much in the character and nature of God. I think of Jesus on the cross when they took him and they beat him. And then they nailed him. They spat upon him. They hit him with their hands. They put crowns on. They tortured his body. And then they nailed it to a cross and hung it up. And what did he say? He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." And then I think of Stephen as he was being stoned, and he cries out and he says, "Lay not this sin to their charge." There was the exercise of mercy in prayer for them. We we ought to be able to be merciful to our most arch of enemies. Listen to what Romans chapter 5, verse 8 and 10 says, "But God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. For if, when we were enemies, we were at enmity, we were God haters, and hated the things of God, and hated the life of God, and we hated anything that had to do with God, when we were yet enemies, we were reconciled to God." How? "By the death of his Son, much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life." And in Colossians chapter 1, verse 21, it says, "And you, that were sometime alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now hath he reconciled." That means made friends with. Listen, he loved you and I when we were vile, wicked, arch enemies, if you will. In the worst condition, we had arms against God. We hated God. Why? Because that's the nature of man, to hate God. In our natural man, we hate God. We were enemies. We were enemies of God in heart and in mind, haters of God and the things of God. Yet he crucified his Son for his enemies. He clothed us with white raiment of his righteousness. He made us to sit at the king's table, at his table, and to eat of his goodness, and to receive his mercy and grace. And he has done such things for us, it is too large a thing. Is it too large a thing for him to ask of us to have mercy on our enemies? Is it too big of a thing for him to ask of us? Over in Exodus chapter 23, verse 4 and 5, in the law he says, "If thou meet thine enemy's ox or his ass going astray, thou shalt surely bring it back to him again." You do a kindness to your enemy. You see his animal out there wandering around, you go take it back to him. Take it back to your enemy. Don't look at that and say, "Oh, that's my enemy's. I hate him. Therefore, we're just going to let his ox just go as far as, matter of fact, I think we'll just butcher up that ox and eat it ourselves." That's what some would do. Don't do that, he says. "If thou seest the ass of him that hateth thee lying under of his burden, and wouldest forbear to help him, thou shalt surely help with him." Here's the old donkey. It's loaded down. And you find him. He's lying under his burden. And it says, not just the man who doesn't like. He says, and you find the ass of him that hateth you. You go take the burden off his ass. You relieve him. You take it back to him. In Proverbs 24:17 says, "Rejoice not when thy enemy falleth." Don't we do that? Yeah, he got his. All right? Isn't that our attitude sometimes? Yeah, God got him that time, didn't he? Well, bless the Lord. God got evil with. "Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, I will repay." And we get all excited because our enemy gets struck. It says, "Rejoice not when thy enemy falleth, and let not thine heart be glad when he stumbleth. Lest the Lord see it, and it displease him, and he turn away his wrath from him." You see, we aren't to get excited over the demise of our enemies. We may praise God for the relief that it may give us, but we do not get excited because God got him for us. That's our attitude. That's the old man that gets in there and says, "Boy, I'm sure glad God has given it to him." Isn't that the way we are? The Bible says don't be that way. Proverbs 25:21, "If thine enemy be hungry, give him bread to eat. If he be thirsty, give him water to drink. For thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head, and the Lord shall reward thee." This is This is the effectual form of vengeance that we're to do, that we're to put on. If an enemy, if he's hungry, you feed him. If he's thirsty, you give him drink. And by doing so, that is an effectual form of vengeance. Did you know that? Because it's what the Lord ordered for us to do. And by doing that, you will either cause great weight upon his conscience, because he has treated you so evilly and you have treated him so good. Or what might happen is that he might treat you even worse than he did. But it brings upon him greater condemnation. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. I will repay. That is true. But you do good to your enemy. You have mercy on your enemy. And the Lord will affect him according to his grace. And I can read all sorts of things in histories and stories and histories where God's people were good to their enemies, and yet their enemies became more vicious. But I'm going to tell you, I also read where their condemnation was even greater, and how they had died in such agony and in such horrible deaths in this life, not to count hell, which was for their eternity. Listen to what our Lord Jesus Christ requires of us in Matthew 5:44, and we'll get to this later whenever I get that far in my preaching. But I say unto you, here it is, love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you and persecute you. What did he say? It says, love your enemies. They hate and abuse us. And what are we supposed to do? We're supposed to respond in love towards them. Why, we're supposed to love our brothers. And sometimes we fail at that, don't we? Let alone loving your enemy. Love your enemies. Bless them. Do good to them. Bless them that curse you. And do good to them that hate you. And pray for them which despitefully use you. I mean, isn't that a contrary to our nature as men? In the flesh it is. It's so contrary to our fleshly nature. Yet in the new man, we can do all of these things, and we're commanded to do these things. That's quite a demand that we have, or quite a duty that we have as far as mercy is concerned, isn't it? What a duty we have. What a responsibility we have, not only to the elect, but to those who are the wicked. What a duty. And then we come to the demand of mercy. What does mercy demand of us? Mercy demands and requires action. It requires an action. We might sympathize. We might empathize. We might have pity. All those poor people. But without action, we're to have action with those who are suffering. But unless we roll up our sleeves to do the work, we have not been merciful. If we just say, oh, those poor, it's like over in James. Then we see a brother or sister and he's poor and naked and destitute and doesn't have enough clothes. And we say to that person, oh, be ye warm and filled, be on your way. But there's no action. Have we displayed any mercy towards them? We haven't. We might say a lot of things, but it requires action. First of all, we can be merciful in prayer. We can intercede in their behalf before the throne of God. Didn't Matthew 5:44 that I just read said that we are to pray for them which despitefully use you? Pray for them. That is certainly an act of mercy that we can do. That we can have intercessory prayer. Pray for them that despitefully use you. Pray that God should be merciful. Can we not pray for God's mercy upon them as well? That God might relieve them? That God might help them? That God should work his will among them as well? That God's will be performed? And not only that God's will would be performed, but that we would be satisfied with his will. Sometimes we pray for the will of the Lord, but then we're not satisfied with it, are we? Because why? Because it didn't go our way. Right? It didn't go our way. Well, what about God's way? Isn't that more important? By far. By far. So we ought to pray that God should be merciful, and that God should work his will, and that we should be satisfied with his will. Pray that we are trying to get this spit out sometimes is not as easy as it looks. Public speaking can be difficult, I'm telling you. But pray that we, in the extending of mercy, should not interfere with his will. In other words, we shouldn't do that and involve ourselves in mercy, which is contrary to the will of God. And well, I'll get to that in a little more detail here in a minute. For even suffering is the will of God. Suffering is the will of God. So the demand of mercy means that ought to be merciful in prayer. We can pray and have mercy, that God would have mercy. We can intercede with him. But second, we're to give without expectation of return. We are to be merciful and to give without expectation of return. The Bible speaks of giving alms, and we're not to forget to give alms. And this is one of the instructions to the New Testament church, that we're to give alms. And in Luke 6, 34 and 35 says, "And if ye lend to them of whom ye have received, what thank have ye? We loan it to our neighbor. We expect to get it returned to us. Don't we? If I let my neighbor down the street borrow my wheelbarrow, I expect him to bring it back to me because, after all, I have loaned it to him and it's mine. That's what we do. If I borrow something from my neighbor, he brings it back. If I borrow something from my neighbor, guess what I do? I usually try to clean it up and bring it back in better condition than when I borrowed it. I used a friend's garage one time to change out a transmission in, or a clutch in. And when it was done, it was all dirty, and I cleaned his floor spotless. And they were really impressed, and they thanked me for doing so good a job in cleaning up, and it was much better than it was than before I started doing the work. And that's the way it ought to be. We land, and that's fine. But it says, if you land, for those who hope to receive, what thank have you? For sinners also lend to receive as much again. But love your enemies and do good, and lend, hoping for nothing again. And your reward shall be great, and ye shall be the children of the highest, for he is kind unto the unthankful and unto the evil. We give to the wicked and to our enemy, and do not expect it ever to be returned. Don't worry about it. You lend it. You let them have it. You give. What does it say? But love your enemies and do good and give and lend, hoping nothing again. And your reward shall be great. And ye shall be the children of the highest. Why? For he is kind to the unthankful and to the evil. Does the wicked man give praise and thanksgiving to God for the sun that shines upon his pate? That's the top of your head, in case some people aren't familiar with the English language. The pate, meaning the top of your head. That sunshine that shines upon his garden and causes it to grow, and God gives the nourishment to the plants and it grows, but that man is unthankful to God. He does not thank God for the rain. The wicked man and the unthankful that do evil have received good from God. God lends to them of his blessings, but they give nothing back to God. If he does that, should not we the more? Should not we also give of the things that we have? For have we not also also received them of the Lord. And when we give without expecting anything back from the unthankful and from our enemies and from the wicked ones, should we not? We shouldn't worry about that. We show that we're the children of God, that we're the children of light, and we walk in the light as He is in the light. We're the children of the highest. In Luke chapter 14, 12 through 14, as He says, then He said unto them that bade Him. Now He's talking to the chief Pharisee and the lawyers, all these important people that were invited to a Sabbath dinner. Now you got to remember that on the Sabbath day, they did no work. They didn't labor. They didn't make the meals on the Sabbath day. They made them the day before. So this was a feast that had been prepared. They knew who was going to be there. They invited Jesus and His disciples, so they were going to be there. So they needed to have a pretty good spread already prepared the day before. Besides this, this shows the righteousness of the Pharisee, because he did all things according to the law, made no preparations on the Sabbath, but rather prepared the day before. There's a lot of things we could talk about in that scripture, but we're not going to. We're going to just focus on this. Luke 14, 12 through 14. Then He said unto them that bade Him. Here's what He said. When thou makest a dinner or a supper, call not thy friends, nor thy brethren, nor thy kinsmen, nor thy rich neighbors, lest they also bid thee again, and a recompense be made thee. Oh, as you invite your friends over, and guess what? They're going to invite you over to their house. Oh, everything's nice, even Stephen. You know, you guys had a good time of fellowship with all your friends. But then what does He say? But when thou makest a feast, and a feast this was. This wasn't just dinner. This was a feast. Call the poor, the maimed, the lame, the blind, and thou shalt be blessed. For they cannot recompense thee, for thou shalt be recompensed at the resurrection of the just. Now do you think this chief Pharisee and these rich lawyers and all these elders and important men of Israel, do you think they're going to invite the lame and the poor and the maimed and the sick into their home for a dinner, for a feast? No. Why? Because it's not in their nature. See, we're to be good and merciful and give without expectation of return to those who are our enemies. It's a demand of mercy that we be merciful. In Deuteronomy 15, 7 through 11, it says, if there be any poor man of you, one of the brethren, within any of thy gates, in the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee. So He's talking about His people, an Israelite. And He says, and thou shalt open up, thou shalt not harden thy heart, nor smite shut thine hand from thy poor brother. But thou shalt open thine hand wide unto him, and shalt surely lend to him sufficient for his need, in that which he wanteth, or lacketh, or is in need of. Beware that there be not a thought in thy wicked heart, saying the seventh year, the year of release, is at hand, and thine evil be against thy poor brethren, thou givest him not, and he cry in the Lord against thee, and it be sin unto thee. Thou shalt surely give him, and thine heart shall not be grieved when thou givest unto him, because for this thing the Lord thy God shall bless thee in all thy works and in all that thou puttest thine hand unto. Now we could get into the details about the seventh year of release, the year of Jubilee. Then we could talk about Jubilee. We talk about the year of release, the seventh year. But narrowing this down, do not have evil in your heart toward your brethren, but rather you give to him in his need. And the Lord will bless you. You know, we're so afraid that we're going to give up something that we have and not get it back because we paid good money for it. Right? We earned it. But rather, Matthew 5:42 is, give to him that asketh of thee. And from whom thou wouldest borrow of thee, turn thou not away. they ask, give it. Give it. Don't worry about it. Let God take care of you. You know, we get so concerned about ourselves, we don't let God take care of us, do we? We think we always know better. We think that we're in control. And we're afraid to open up our hand and be bountiful towards others and help others. And by the way, I do want to thank the church for the blessings that we've been able to be to others and be merciful to others in the faith. We, you know, with Sister Pound and then our dear Sister Jovina, you folks have been wonderful in that. We're to put forth our hands to work. We can pray, we can give of the goods that we have, but we can also lend a hand. Did you know that? We can lend a hand. We can do work that will help. We can shovel snow. We can gather wood. We can help and labor for those who are truly in need. The elderly, those poor in health, those unable to do for themselves, those who suffer from mental disability. We can help these people with our hands. As the Lord brings them to us, if we become aware of that, we can certainly work to do that. Can we not? I'm sure that each of us, as we can, do. Before that dear lady across the street passed away this past summer was, I believe, or fall, I would go over all winter and I would plow out her driveway. Why? Because she needed somebody to do that for her, and I knew it would be a blessing. I knew it was what God wanted me to do to supply for her in this need. Was she a believer? No. This was the best life she was going to have, and I wanted to make it as good as I could. Doing good acts of mercy out of a kind heart and compassion on men whose only heaven is what they have here on earth. When they talk about heaven on earth, this is heaven on earth for wicked men. In this fleshly body, you know why? This should cause our hearts to mourn after these poor wretched creatures, over those who have not been saved or have believed in Christ, who have not received the grace of salvation. Why? Because this is the best that they will ever have. This wretched, miserable life is the best they'll ever have. The best of times, they'll be wretched and filled with depravity. It is the best of days, though they be very short. 60 years, 50 years, 80 years, what is that? Only a short part of time. And then this is the best of life, though it be death. This is the best. Why can't we make the best for them according to the will of God? We should make men as comfortable as they can be, even miserable, wretched enemies, because this is the best they will ever have. And guess what, folks? For those who are in Christ, this is the worst you'll ever have. This is the worst you'll ever have. And no matter what they do to us, fear not him that can kill the body, but him that can kill both body and soul and cast them into hell. But what if we're believers in Christ and trusted Christ, this is the worst that we could possibly have. And you know what? That ought to be a great encouragement to us. But there's the demise of mercy, and I'll try to hurry up here. Mercy is such a wonderful quality. Is even given to some of God's children as a gift. There is a gift of mercy over in Romans chapter 12, verse 8. But mercy is to be used, we're all to be merciful. And it is to be exercised as such. But while we are to be merciful, we must be careful in mercy if we don't properly use it in a strictly biblical sense. Do you know you can misuse mercy? Suffering has purpose and is disposed upon man by the Lord. We have suffering that God brings upon us. And some suffering is for judgment of sin. Did you know that? Some is because of judgment of sin. The lazy person who will not work will suffer without his finances. And do you think we ought to jump in there and supply him? Does the lazy man learn anything if we try to take care of his financial problems because he's lazy? God brings the judgment, the consequences, a fruit of what they have done. Whatsoever man has soweth, so shall he also reap. And if he reaps because he has no money, it's because he has not worked. Let God deal with his heart accordingly. can misuse mercy. We really can. Suffering is to develop character in the believer and make him fit for service. Why do we suffer? It is to make us fit for service, to give us experience of life so we might be able to minister to others. So we ought to make sure that we are careful in our mercy, that we do not interfere with God molding and making a person, a man, a woman, into the person he wants them to be. And then some suffering is to harden the heart of wicked man, thus increasing his condemnation. An excellent example of that, a good biblical example, is Pharaoh. God said, let my people go. And guess what? Pharaoh didn't want to do that. It hardened the heart of Pharaoh. And every single plague made Pharaoh harder and harder and harder in his heart to his just condemnation. So the Bible says that God hardened the heart of Pharaoh. How did he do that? By telling Pharaoh to do something he didn't want to do. We need to be careful with mercy. Mercy and truth. Mercy and truth are not at odds with each other. They're not enemies of each other. And there's a danger that we might compromise truth for the sake of being merciful. We don't want to hurt anybody's feelings. We don't want to make them sad. We don't want to make them mad. And so we'll tend to be merciful and form our words in such a way that we, what? Disguise the truth? Hide the truth? No, tell them the truth, but tell them in love, the scripture tells us. We don't want to hurt anyone's feelings, so we fail to tell the truth. And we might find ourselves unable to be firm and decisive. And we might, and you know what? Because we're afraid we might cause them hurt or offense. In Psalm 25:10 says, all the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth unto such as keep his covenant and his testimony. Psalm 85:10, mercy and truth are met together. Righteousness and peace have kissed each other. And in Proverbs 3:3, let not mercy and truth forsake thee. Bind them about thy neck. Write them upon the table of thy heart. Telling the people in truth, in love, is in itself merciful. Telling them the truth in love is in itself merciful. You are not being merciful if you don't tell the truth. Did you know that? Mercy, you know what else? Mercy never violates God's principles and standards. It never compromises truth nor cooperates with the ungodly. Mercy does not do that. Listen to Matthew 23:23. Jesus is instructing the Pharisees. He says, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye pay tithe of mint and anise and cumin, and of the weightier matters of the law, judgment, mercy, and faith. These ought ye to have done, and not leave the other undone. In other words, you don't just keep part of the law. You just don't compromise it. You're to do it all. They were so nitpicky on the very leaves, and they counted out the leaves, make sure they gave the right amount of the tithe. He says, you left out those weightier matters of the law, which are mercy and judgment and faith. You forgot about those. You see, mercy never violates God's principles. Never. We do not extend mercy in violation of the principles and laws of God. You know what else will also turn away heart, or turn away mercy? A hard heart. We ought not to have a hard heart. You know, there's a medium in there, if you will. We don't want to violate the principles of God, but we want to be merciful. We don't want to have a hard heart, but we should not have a heart that's so soft that we compromise the Word of God over it. That's called the demise of mercy. Moving on, last point here. See, we're going to get to the end. It's called the dividend of mercy. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. As with all the Beatitudes, we have an inescapable promise of blessing and happiness. The blessings, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. We are the most blessed and happiest people on earth if we follow the Savior's discourse or direction. If we're obedient in these things, we can't be but the happiest people on earth. Why are we so sad a lot of times? Because we are not following the direction of the Lord. Why are we not the most blessed and the most encouraged? Because sometimes we get pretty self-centered and turn our eyes upon us and what about us as if we're the big picture. We aren't the big picture. Remember, these instructions are to his true disciples and to his church, and thus to all the churches of the Lord Jesus Christ. It is by these very traits that we are marked out, that we are different from anything that the world has ever seen. That makes you unique. When a believer follows these things that are taught to us here in the Beatitudes, we are different from anything that the world can possibly know or has ever seen. It is these very instructions that sets the world against us. It's because we're merciful, because we're meek, because we're lowly. These are the things that cause the world to be against us. Because we serve the living and true God, who shall bring every man's to work into judgment and reward the righteous. Now, it says, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. To speak of this as we obtain mercy because we're being merciful is to misinterpret or misunderstand what this verse is talking about. It's not saying that we got to be merciful and then we can have mercy. No. But rather, the merciful are such only because they have received mercy. We've received mercy, and because we've received mercy, we have mercy to give. We receive mercy of God, therefore we are merciful. The Savior's blood was placed upon the mercy seat in the behalf of his people, his chosen ones, so that they might obtain mercy which flows so freely to them. God's mercy flows to us. And because we have received mercy, therefore we show mercy. We are merciful because God was merciful and is merciful to us. It is the gift, it is a grace gift of Christ that we are even able to show mercy. I am not, if I don't show mercy, then I am not an object of the grace of God. As hard as that might sound, if I don't show mercy, then I show that I'm not an object of the grace of God. For mercy and grace go hand in hand. Our text says here, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. And truly we do. Each and every day we obtain mercy. Some of these kind mercies are the ones that the wicked enjoy. For instance, the sunshine shines on the wicked and the just. Every day, albeit very cold, but even this is the blessing and mercy of God. What do you think kills those bugs off? So we don't have uncontrolled bug population in the wintertime or in the summertime. We don't have much bugs in the wintertime. But there's got to be some bug kill. Or else in the summertime, they're miserable with bugs. So even that is a blessing, counted a blessing. We don't have cockroaches that are 3 and 4 inches long like they do in Florida. In fact, I don't think I've ever seen a cockroach up here. So if someone in the South wants to have a place with no cockroaches, they ought to move up here, right? Matter of fact, there isn't even any rattlesnakes up here in North Idaho. They stop at the Washington state line. I don't know what it is. You won't find rattlesnakes in Idaho. They're over there in Washington. They might even have a political label, too. That's not what my sermon's about. Let me move on. All right. But lest it be misunderstood, the world made for the dwelling place of the wicked, but for the righteous. Amen. Do you know that? The world was not made for a dwelling place of the wicked, but of the righteous. Matthew chapter 13. You can go back to Genesis. You start there. But this present state of the world, is because sin entered into the world. And it was cursed because of sin. But it will be remade for the people of God. And thus not only shall we inherit the earth, but we shall also do so in His eternal mercy. You see, we are told to come before the throne of grace that we might obtain grace and mercy. What a great privilege we have that when we need grace and mercy and we would like to obtain it, we go before the throne of grace and ask for it. And when we ask for it, we obtain it. I believe there's a coming day too in the not too distant future when the children of God will be persecuted and will be branded as enemies of the state and a danger to the populace. You know that? And it will be criminal to be a child of God, and in particular a Baptist. But let me assure you that it will come, that in that day also there will be a great mercy demonstrated to the people of God. Now here's a verse. You don't hear it preached very often. Isaiah 57:1. The righteous perisheth, and no man layeth it to heart. Don't care. Another righteous man dies. Hallelujah, right? As far as the wicked are concerned. The righteous man perisheth, and no man layeth it to heart. And merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is taken away from evil. God is merciful to His righteous, merciful men because He takes them out of the earth to keep them from the evil yet to come. Folks, persecution arises and you are taken by the wicked. It is only to save you. God took you in His mercy to save you from that which is worse yet to come upon these men. Even in death, we shall be carried across the mighty deep by mercy. Oh, what a wonderful thing. We shall obtain mercy. Mercy is always ours who are in Christ. We have mercy continuously. Mercy comes and it stays and it flows. Listen. Mercy comes and flows towards us. But it ebbs at hell's shores. Mercy cannot be extended to them who are in hell. It is only to His people. It is to His people, and we receive it continuously. We are surrounded by it. We're covered by it. It supports us from underneath. It is the mercy of God. Blessed are they who are merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. Isn't it a marvelous thing that by God's grace we can be merciful? This is not an easy thing. When some people think that these sayings of Christ are just pithy little sayings.